Hello, everybody. Just bear with me for a few minutes. I got to figure out some technical. Just got to make sure that this is actually working. We'll get into it. So give me one second,
Hello,
Mitchell.
everybody. Just bear with me for a few minutes.
All right, sounds like it's working. Just give me 2 seconds. Okay, so this is actually a restream because yesterday I tried to do this. Total disaster. If anybody's listening or watching today, listen to your, let me know if the audio is not working. Just get in the chat. If you can't hear me, let me know in the chat so then I can adjust and see if we can figure this out. Also, I've been having some Wi-Fi issues. I have no idea why. So if this drops, I'll be right back. So I guess with that, we'll get started again. So today is sort of the first stream, I guess, the official first stream. I'm hoping that it works and lasts the entire time, where I'm going to review the Smugglers holster that I've been working on for the last, I guess, few years now, to bring everybody up to speed. To figure out where the project is at, or to see where the project is at, to see what I've done to get to this point, and where we're going from here. So, to start, a bit of background on me is I come from a makeup effects prop background. That was where I first started back when I was like young, my 19, 20 years old. I went out and started working in the film and movie or TV and movie industry and did that for about 7 years and then sort of progressed into more of the art and graphic design. But the skills that I had learned in those 7 years were ones that I apply today. And it's, I apply them to weird stuff today. Like I do the odd makeup. But I apply them to stuff like baking, which you wouldn't think, but you can actually do mold making and all this kind of stuff, baking stuff. So it was pretty cool. But one of the things is that those skills I've always wanted to kind of apply to things I enjoy, and one of the things I enjoy doing still is making props. So this particular, I'm getting a lot of drop frames, so if it's really choppy, let me know, guys, in the chat. Just gonna ch type in the chat here for a sec. Sorry. So, getting some drop frames, not too good internet. We'll figure out what's going on. Hopefully it kicks up a bit. Okay, so anyway, not sure this is working all that well, guys. Getting a lot of drop frames, not a lot of. I'll just 1 second. I'll be right back, guys. Okay, back. Sorry about that. Just trying to figure out, sort out the Wi-Fi a bit here. Hopefully that goes up a bit. So, anyway, where I was at was that, yes, I thought this would be a great project. I've always loved this character. And so it's been one of those things where I wanted to do for quite some time. And I guess I started just doing it. And before I could do it, obviously, I needed a pattern. And I looked around on the internet, and there was sort of a few sort of here and there patterns, but nothing really all that definitive. There was, you know, somebody would be like, oh, the pouches are this big, blah, blah, blah. And somebody said, well, I made this, and it was good enough. And that's fine. And, you know, it's each their own. If you're happy with what you made, great. But for me, I thought, well, you know what? This is an opportunity because it looks like there's not really been anything done that where somebody had sat down and said, let's really just look at this. Let's figure out what the little details are down to like the most obsessive degree. And let's go from there and make the most accurate thing we can. So I started out looking and doing a lot of research. And one of the things I found out right away was that, you know, there's a bunch of different movies, and obviously each one of them have a different style. They're all made by different people. There's just, you know, there's just a lot of differences, and you don't really notice it when you just kind of like look at them in the movies. They all kind of look the same and you just don't really pay attention, but when you really start looking into it, there's these tons of little details. So that was the first thing I said, well, you know, if I'm going to make one for myself, which one am I going to make? And then if I'm going to make that one, you know, how detailed am I going to go? And I realized that when I started putting it on the forums, like the RPF and stuff, there was, and Rebel Legion, there was people out there that just liked all different ones. So I thought, well, you know, if I'm going to be doing one, you know, maybe it's not going to be too much trouble to do, you know, two or three. So I started that, and the problem was is that turned into quite the task. So what I did was, let's go through here to give you an example here. So I started off looking at the patterns. Sorry, I'm just gonna find this thing. Everything is all over the place. Live, eh? It's hard to do things live. So I started out here by just starting paper. I figured, you know, paper was easy. You know, you could kind of get the patterns down, see if things were sizing correctly, and all that kind of stuff. But, you know, you realize pretty quick, and I knew this from before, is paper is really not a very good medium to use when you're trying to do work in some other medium. For example, leather, it's just a terrible, you know, it doesn't transfer well. For example, paper is, well, paper thin. So you don't get the thickness that you need. You don't get, it doesn't fold correctly, that kind of stuff. So it just wasn't the right, you know, thing to do. So what I did from there was, I went into foam. So foam is a little bit better. You can get it in the thickness that is actually quite similar to what it had been in leather. This is fairly similar. And I was able to start prototyping this a little bit easier. You can see that, you know, I went and found the patterns online that people were using and, you know, tried to translate that into this foam piece, and you could see that it wasn't working. There was, you know, it bulges out, you know, it just doesn't look right. So then I started, you know, adjusting the sizes to see if I could figure something a little better. It was too small. You know, you could sort of see here a little bit where I was trying to get different, you know, where the bends were, where the sewing would be. And I sort of came up with something that sort of worked. So I created that, and you know, came in here and started, you know, comparing the two to figure out if I could, you know, if they were looking generally like correct. You know, taking screen caps from the internet, those kind of things that I could find, you know, and sort of comparing from there. from there I said, well, okay, cool, that's sort of working, so maybe I'll go into some leather and see. And I think at this point I was able to get, as you can sort of see here, probably won't focus, but you can sort of see that things were coming together and I was starting to get the pattern sizes. Now, one of the things that was difficult with this project was that when you are, sorry, when you're trying to size something, it's really easy. Well, this is a bit of a tip for anybody out there. If you're trying to size something, find something that you know within that project that you have access to, and you can sort of start basing your sizes off of all of that. For example, if you kind of, I was able to get a hold of one of these. These are the little greeblies. Now, if you don't know what a greebly is just sort of a term in, the prop making, whatever, communities. That's sort of just like a, just a thing. It's just a thing. It's a name for anything, just little bits and pieces and stuff. So I was able to get a hold of one of those, which is a carburetor from an old model kit, is what they used. So that I was able to start basing all my measurements on this, and I was able to start kind of saying, okay, like, is this looking correct? Generally, compared to the leather size, what thickness was the leather? How wide is the pouch? You can kind of sort of see here where I'd started that kind of process of figuring out the sizes, and everything was working out from that point. Let me see. I was able to get. Now, one of the things that was pretty cool was I was heading down to Arizona for vacation, and there was an exhibit where all these costumes were on display. And I said, well, that's a perfect opportunity because I can get down there and I can actually get up and close and get some photos and see what was going on. So I went in there and spent probably an hour in just in front of this one costume, just taking as many pictures as I could. I think I came to be about 400 or something in the end. It was ridiculous. I went down to the zone of area, and opened up all the photos and realized that I didn't catch a lot of the details that I needed. So I ended up on the way back going again, paying another whatever it was, $40, and sitting there for another hour just taking more and more photos of all the stuff I didn't capture. But the result was I was able to get some really highly detailed photos that allowed me to start comparing. Now, this is only for one holster, which was kind of a, just sucked, but it gave me a starting point for all the other holsters. I mean, the actor Harrison Ford, who wore these in the movies, it didn't change much over the three films. So the generally you can sort of figure out the sizes from there. So I was able to kind of go from there. Let me see. I've got a list here. I'm kind of going through to so you guys know. So I'm awkwardly looking over here, trying to figure this out. I know there's a lot of drop frames. I'm sorry about that. I wish I could figure out what was going on. But so from there, I was, I kind of was able to start creating that. So if you kind of, as I took my Greebly here and threw it in here and started looking, and I could look from the angles and say, that's falling in the right spot there, and that makes sense how much it's overlapping here. It just was a good reference point, and that was where it started. In future streams, I'm going to go a little bit more into detail into those specifics. But to start out with, that's kind of where it was at. Let's see here. And just to go back a bit, what I didn't want to do was just create sort of something. I mean, I had the time and I had the, you know, the energy to just sort of create a pattern or a holster that was like as detailed as possible. There's no time constraints for me. I just like, I'm going to keep researching until I find all the details. And I had no real preconceived notions of what things were. So part of it was that when I came to this, initially I was guessing. And I mean, a lot of people probably had done a lot of this groundwork, but I sort of put that aside and said, you know, I'm going to come at this with fresh eyes and not be sort of biased by anybody else's stuff. And when I started looking at things, I got another image for you guys to... all over the place. So yeah, so I started creating, that's just an image for you guys to check out for a sec there. So I started off, and you can kind of see how I was just sort of guessing here at how a lot of these things might have worked. I mean, I couldn't, one of the things that was difficult with this holster is you can't see behind the buckles very well. There's not a lot of photos that show it. So a lot of people had kind of done some guesswork as to how it was going to, you know, work. And here's one of the, the things or some of the ideas I thought, well, maybe they're kind of like this, where it was these little clips, you know, that could kind of swing and swivel, because when you see the, you know, the actor walk, they kind of swivel with them. And so I created these types of things here, but as I looked into it more and more and more, and thought about it more and more, it's just too complicated for really what it was, and it just didn't really make any sense. So I was able to get little pictures here and there of the backgrounds or the back of the buckles, and I could tell that they were more like this over here. So it was a bit of a progress there to see, you know, how they would work. You know, to figure out how that would work. And as I worked more and more into all the different holsters, I started seeing, yeah, that's how it was done. This, you know, and the thing with the prop industry, and I did this all the time myself, is when you're on a budget and a time crunch, you do things as fast and simple as possible. You just don't spend time creating these intricate things. It needs to last, you know, for the duration of the 2-3 week shooting, and that's it. It doesn't, you know, and you can repair it. You make one or two or three or four or whatever, and that's it. You just, they're done. And if they don't last the rest of the movies, you know, the sequels and stuff, who cares? You make another one. So the simpler was better. And as I started kind of going through there and figuring that out, things started coming together. Now, one of the things with this is when I was making the patterns, and I'll show you guys the patterns in a little bit here, is that, you know, I wanted them to be accurate. And so what I started to do was said, well, you know, how do I bend, you know, if I'm going to bend some metal, and I've bent metal in my time, but I know that it's really hard to get, just the way that the medium works, it just tends to, you know, so I got on some metal forums and I started putting out these, you know, this is what I needed, and how would this work, and if I wanted to line these two up perfectly, blah blah blah. So, you know, I was working with them to try to figure out, you know, and these experts are saying, you know, okay, yeah, you gotta do this and try this and make sure you bend it here and try to use this metal and this thickness, and this is what your result will be. So that was a kind of a cool little side tangent just to get those little details right. One of the things that has been the most difficult is these greeblies. You know, it's weird, because I'll tell you, you're like, here's two carburetor pieces that I have. One of these I purchased out of a kit, and the one I purchased out of the kit had, you know, it had some molding issues. It didn't line up. The molds are probably old, but you know, the average person just doesn't care. But it bothered me, so I said, you know, I contacted the company, I think it's Revell, and I said, you know, I don't like the way this mold works. Can you send me a replacement part? So they did. You know, I got it, and I said, great, fantastic. And then I started looking at them a little bit more when I was doing these measurements, as you can kind of see on screen here. And I realized pretty quickly that these weren't the same. There's a lot of differences between these two. And you can't really see them. I'll see if I can give you a bit of an example here. Here, this, maybe you can kind of see this, if it'll focus. I don't think it will. Anyway, there's just differences. There's slight differences. And the more I looked at these, the more I realized there's all these little sort of differences. Which made me think, you know, maybe these are older molds, or maybe there's different production molds in different parts of the world where they sort of sold these things, and which one was accurate. So I was able to go back to the photos and sort of say, oh, well, you know, and unfortunately, I think the ones that are sold in the kit today are not the original ones that were used. So I sort of said, you know, people that are making these holsters may want an original, and I'm sort of going off on a tangent because I got a couple things I'll come back to, but the people that are making this holster kind of probably want the original props, but some of these, or the original Greeblies, but some of these things are just not possible to get. For example, I'll give you a bit of an example here. If you sort of check it out here, this piece here on the screen is a disc. People just call it the disc on the side, right? And you know, you sit there and you go, well, what is this thing? And you know, research and check it out and all this sort of stuff. But I was down at the machine shop with my friend who owns the machine shop who's the boss of the machine shop at the University of Victoria here where I live. And he doesn't do drugs or anything as far as I know. And he was like, he looked at that and said, you know, that looks like a bud buster. And I was like, what is a bud buster? I have no idea. I don't do drugs myself, so this is not a thing that, you know, I've even ever come across in my life. And he says, yeah, it's like people that smoke pot, they use it to grind up the pot or whatever. And I was like, what? So I went and started looking online, and sure enough, this thing looks exactly like what you would find. It's exactly what it would be. The thing is, these holsters are made, or this, you know, between 1976 and 80 something. And so these parts were probably either impossible to get now, or they were custom made. And likely this one was custom made. And I knew these guys down in the shop, you know, hey, let's put a bud buster on there. It'll be funny. Nobody will notice. And so that's probably what they did. And so getting these little Greeblies together and stuff, and there's a couple of them that we'll take a look at in a sec. They're just not possible to really get. Nobody knows what they are. The research that I've done into them has been just dead ends. So anyway, that's a lot on Greeblies. We'll go on from there. But you can see how the amount of detail and stuff that I've kind of put in, because where I'm going with this is that I think the best way to do this for everybody was to create 3D files that people could print. If I can get the measurements down and just basically get them to a point where they're as accurate as we can possibly get, people can go print them and stuff like that and try to pass until we can sort of figure out what's going on with them and find the actual things and stuff. So anyway, that said, let me just go back to my list so I don't get off on a tangent here. That brings me to other things. So, you know, I was one of the examples here is that, you know, these are sparklets canisters. And these are actually like little, there's like soda canisters for like a 1970s soda machine, and I was able to find I think 20 of them on eBay, and you know, fantastic, find 20 of them on eBay, ship them here, everything's fine. They were from the UK because that's where these holsters were built. Get them over here. The problem is that you can't ship CO2. They just won't do it. you know, well, they'll do it, but they'll do it for a ridiculous amount of price. So the person that I had these shipped to in the UK had to go and punch out every single one of these and release the gas, and then they could ship them. And even then, they were still pretty expensive. So getting things like this is difficult. You know, finding them for a reasonable price. You know, there's a lot of people out there that are doing these props and stuff, and they buy these up, and the prices skyrocket. But getting them has been a bit of a challenge. So anyway, let's go. All right. So to bring things back a little bit, I had all this information that I was gathering, and you know, as I kind of worked through it, you know, I could see that there was different, you know, variations and stuff, and so I got into making the patterns, and let me start with that, and I'll show you guys. Let's get those out of the way, so I'm kind of okay. So this is what this led me to, was this pattern. Now, when I started making these things, I started with the buckles. And as you can see here, these were my sort of original concepts behind how I thought these might work. Different sort of clip styles. You know, how did the one hardware kind of swing and stuff like that. So I had all these kind of different ideas about how that might work. You know, grooves and cuts and stuff. But as I got into it, I realized, and I was able to get more, I mean, I just had an image up that I closed, but you can sort of see that somebody would, on the RPF or on the Rebel Legion would, oh, I had this photo that's just been kicking around on my hard drive. And it was enough to sort of say, ah, that's totally not how they did it. So from there, I kind of went in and I said, okay, this is how it works. And using different measurement techniques and stuff, I was able to sort of get these more and more refined. Now, one of the things that has been a huge, huge issue with this project is that everything that changes has this weird knock-on effect. When I went to the Seattle exhibit, I would take a photo, and then I'd get it home and I'd see this little thing in there. I'd be like, well, that measurement is different. So I would go and I'd tweak this pattern, and then I was like, well, that measurement affects this measurement, and then that measurement affects, and it's just this weird super knock-on effect, where one little thing will just make the whole entire project a different size. And it's when this thing was built, you know, they didn't have any really care. They were just like, Harrison Ford is this size, and we're going to just sort of measure it out and make whatever we want, because when you're the first doing something, you don't have to copy anything. Obviously, you can do whatever you want. So, but when you're sitting there trying to figure that out, you know, in retrospect, that's very difficult to do. So anyway, these little tweaks, and what would happen is I would make something. I'd have this whole entire project basically close to complete. I'd find a different measurement that would throw off everything, and I have to go back and adjust all these patterns. Super pain in the ass. But you know, it worked, and it's working, and you can sort of see on the screen here that, you know, I was able to, you know, get these things to start coming together. Now, if anybody out there is thinking, oh, I'll just screen cap all this stuff because, you know, Walker's never going to release any of this stuff, I would say maybe just hold off on that. Some of these measurements are still just not true. Some of them are repeats. I just kind of put them in there. I still have to sort of get the final ones, but anyway. So this, like I say, this is originally what I thought they could have been like, and then I worked into this is probably more what they were like, based on, you know, the photographs and stuff. Let me just get back on track here a little bit. And I'll go more into this detail in greater detail in you know other streams here, so we can kind of you know, you guys can sort of see the level of detail and stuff, and we can really get into it. You sort of see here's the little buckle. But the basically what I'm trying to get to you today is that these patterns have been kind of a progression they've evolved and evolved and evolved, and the more information that comes in, the more I have to go back and tweak them, and that. The second part of this that's been a bit of a challenge for me is that when I was going to make them for me only, that, you know, I'm the same. I just make my size and I adjust it accordingly. But I want to make this pattern for all of you guys, which makes it a bit difficult because you're all different sizes, right? You're not all Harrison Ford and neither am I. So trying to figure out how to keep this accurate, but also, adjustable or customizable for everybody has been a bit of a challenge to figure out how to do that within the pattern so it doesn't wreck the look and the feel and the aesthetic of it. Because obviously the last thing you would want is, say, you know, somebody like me who's a little bigger, if you stretch everything out, it just looks wrong, right? So where do you put those breaks in the pattern so you guys can do them? So that's been a bit of a challenge. Go up here, you can kind of see getting the greeblies, figuring out the different sizes of them, the shapes, to getting them ready. One of the things I've been trying to do, and there's been a few people that have offered on the forums, which is fantastic, but I want to get these three done for 3D, as I mentioned, but I need to find somebody that has the obsessive desire to make sure that every detail is, you know, top notch, because I don't want to create a pattern and then have somebody go and 3D print a bunch of these things and then they just don't fit or they look totally nasty. So that's something I'm trying to work on, figure out somebody that can kind of do that to that degree or to my standards, which is pretty high, unfortunately. But so yeah, that's kind of where that is. The pattern is really quite close to being complete, other than there's these few details, and obviously I need to put in episode 7, and there's now it sounds like there's going to be a sort of a prequel episode. So I've got to sort of figure out that too, and that. But once that's done, the next step was, I said, well, okay, like, just taking these patterns and just throwing them on the internet and saying good luck everybody really didn't seem like it was going to result in a lot of success for a lot of people, because unless you know what you're doing in leather, unless you kind of know what all the details that I've sort of gathered in my brain, which is, you know, these sort of these little details are things that I learned and I just kind of retained in there. And I said, I can't remember them all. So I'm going to start writing them down. And as I started writing them down, I said, well, this is information and details that I think other people are going to want to know as well. Because it's going to make their experience all the more rich, but it's also going to help them complete it. So I said, I think the best way to do this is to put it in a book. And so I started creating this book, which you can see that it's sort of based on those kind of Four Dummies books where, I said, like, here's some background, here's kind of, you know, all these different, how to use this book, you know, kind of why this book is the way it is and stuff. And then going into that, this is where, for example, the different patterns are going to be. Now, another challenge with this, obviously, is that when I print my patterns, I'm going to do them one of two ways. I'm going to either take the patterns into a professional print shop and have them print them, you know, on large format paper, or I'm going to take them in and get them laser cut onto, plastic. So you know, I can use them over and over again, or just make sure that it's nice, rigid thing. I can actually probably, one thing I may try as well is the laser cutter that I have access to can actually laser cut leather. So I may try one that I just laser cut the pattern right out of the leather. I'm not sure that's going to work for various reasons, but when I give the pattern to you guys, I can give you the full pattern as well. But for the average person at home trying to make this kind of thing, I think it needs to be accessible. So if you look at some of the patterns, just go back here for a sec. Like, for example, this holster, I mean, if you look at this, I got my DL44 here, which needs to be completed. And also a shout out to Boba Dett for these great parts. I got them on the RPF. There's a site as well made by another guy, and I can't recall his name, sorry. But Boba sort of did this, and it's fantastic. But once I started getting these parts, you know, I created this pattern for the holster, and, you know, I said, okay. You know, I put this together and sort of, you know, threw this in here and realized pretty quickly that's not going to work, right? It's just not the right size. It's not right. So the other problem, and like as I was sort of going on, is that this is not going to fit on an 8.5 by 11 piece of paper. It's just the way it is for a lot of these pieces, especially the holster part that goes around the leg. So I'm going to have to create this book where people can print and sort of place them together. And it's not an ideal way to do it, but I have to make it accessible to everybody. So anyway, let's see here. So yeah, I'm all these pages will be filled with the pattern where you guys will be able to sort of print them, put them together, use them as pattern. And I, like I say, I'll also supply the full one. So if you want to go to a professional print shop, you can do that. So, you know, I got to fill these in, and then I sort of said, you know, like I was saying before, there's a lot of details, you know, for example, choosing your leather. Now, one of the things that I realized a long time ago when I was doing prop work was that leather work is an art all on its own. And if you don't do it often and stuff, it's very difficult to know what you're doing. You go into a leather shop and there's hides from all types of different animals. You've got different, you've got different qualities, thicknesses, tans, all this kind of stuff. And it's overwhelming, honestly. If you're trying to go in there and make one specific, project, you walk in and you look at these giant cow hides and you're like, this is like $300 or whatever. And you're sitting there going, is this what I need? How much of this am I going to need? You know, what happens if there's a tick bite or whatever in the middle? So I decided, like, I'll get that information out here so you can kind of go through when you're working on your holsters and find that information. So you know how to cut it, how to sew it, and all you sort of see along the side here. I think I have a few which maybe are not here now, but yeah. So there's a few here along the side. I've put links in here to videos and various articles where you can get even more information, so you can kind of go into it as much. But I also wanted to recommend tools. I wanted to recommend products, that kind of stuff. So you can all go out and get the stuff that I think that you would need to make this the most accurate you can. So I want to put this into a book that you guys can get for free. It's a digital download, and then you can work through and get all the information, all the information you need. So from there, let me just look to my notes here. So yeah, that will be a free digital download. I may do a Kickstarter campaign for a physical book or some physical patterns, Say, I would love, and I think it would help you guys a great deal if these patterns were either fully printed or laser cut. Laser cut is awesome. I've done it before. The patterns, especially with like leather and stuff like that, when you have a nice laser cut plastic pattern, it's just fantastic because it doesn't move, it doesn't bend. You just put it on there, bam, you get a perfect pattern cut out. So I'm going to look at that later in the future, but for right now, the plan moving forward with this project, and I hope, I mean, my first stream was much better. I'm really all over the place today because I was thinking about it and I have a lot more information I just want to get to you guys. But moving forward, the idea here is to get those greeblies ready for 3D. So, you guys can get those and start printing them. I need to finish the patterns, as you can sort of see. There's and next week on Sunday, if you look at my schedule below or on Twitch, I think it is. You can see next Sunday at 3 p.m. Pacific time. I'm going to be going over episode 4 pouches, so we'll go into a lot of detail with those. I'll work on those. We'll see if we can finalize those kind of things. And I'm going to work through each of the different parts of the pattern until I get all the way up to episode 7, and then, possibly the prequels eventually. But I need to finish those patterns. I'm going to continue streaming those different parts of the project as long as you guys care, so you can get all that information, see where things are at, offer suggestions, offer criticism, critiques, feedback, all that kind of stuff. We can have debates. I mean, next week's episode 4 pouch, there's a debate on how it was created. I'm convinced it's one way. Everybody else seems to be convinced it's another way. So we can sort of get into that a little bit and debate what I think it is and see if you guys can convince me otherwise. And then yeah, and then we'll just sort of keep going until we're sort of finished this project. And the reason, just so you know, the reason I sort of, because I know a couple of you guys are coming from the RPF and the Rebel Legion forum, and you're probably wondering, well, why are you not just making forum posts anymore? And the reality is that when I was doing this project, however many months, years ago, sorry, it's been a long time. When I would work on the project, I would spend 4 or 5 hours working on something, and then I would have to spend another hour or two at the end of the day putting all these photos together and taking, screenshots and all this kind of stuff and putting together these long forum posts that, were just taking a long time to do and a lot of effort. And streaming, being able to stream to you guys and get some instant feedback, and I mean, instant feedback is interesting, and the fact is just me today watching this, but getting feedback from you guys instantly and being able to, sort of, go through and, turn things around and say, well, look at this part here, it's not working right, kind of thing, is a lot better for me than trying to write these long posts and describe every single detail. And I know there's people out there that are sitting there going, yeah, it sucks, man, because I kind of like just reading it. But if we want this project to kind of move forward, we've got to do it in a way, or I have to do it in a way that's going to be most time efficient for me. I've got a lot of other things. I've got family. I've got Marine search and rescue. I've got a lot of things in my life that I've got to prioritize, and so I can't spend time, unfortunately, making these giant blog forum posts for you guys anymore. So I'm hoping that the stream works for you guys. If I can't get this technical nonsense worked out, what I'll end up doing is just putting up videos. I'll pre-record them, put them up, and we can have, talks on them on a live stream where I'm not kind of going, but there's not, I can kind of tone down the live stream so there's not so many things going on. Maybe I can kind of get that to work a little better. Yeah, I can see things are skipping and stuff, so that's unfortunate. Hopefully this guy worked for you guys. But I think that's a good start. I think you guys can see where I'm at, see sort of how I got to this point. It's been a bit all over the place today. I'm sorry about that, but Hopefully you get the impression of where things are at. And I don't think there's much more today that I can sort of show you guys or say. So I think we'll probably leave it at that for today. If you have any questions, you can look down below on my Twitch and on my YouTube. There's my Twitter down there. Just send me a tweet. If you're interested in following this project, please just like, subscribe, follow, whatever you do down here or whatever, wherever it is. I don't know. But just, you know, do that, like, follow and subscribe, and then you'll be able, you know, you'll get those notifications when I come back on, and, you know, kind of go forward and see how it works. So, yeah, so thanks for joining me today. We'll, with your support, I'm hoping that we can get this project done a lot quicker, and it'll be fun. So, cool. Sounds good. All right, well, until next week, I'll see you guys, and for all those who joined me today, I saw a few that sort of stopped by. Thanks. Appreciate it. For those watching later, appreciate watching. And we'll see you later.